My name is Pavel Exner, and I have the honor to chair this session. Our first speaker is Rinat Kashayev. A few words to introduce him. So he comes originally from Bashkiria, studied at Moscow State University, got his PhD in 1992 in Protvino, and then he worked in various places, Helsinki, Lyon. Now he is a professor at the University of Geneva. He works in knot theory, hyperbolic geometry, and a lot of other subjects in mathematical physics, order of about 60 papers, maybe more, some with really great people like Ludwig Fadeev. But I think I will not steal more of his time. So, Rinat Kashayev.
Thank you, Pavel. Thank you for introduction. It's great to be here. I'd like to thank the scientific committee and the organizers for the invitation. So I will talk about Teichmuller TQFT. TQFT stands for topological quantum field theory. And my subject is motivated by Chern-Simon theory, namely it's a quantum version of it. My concern is about the non-compact gauge groups. So briefly, what it's all about. So we have a non-compact Lie group, for example, GL2R. R could be real or complex numbers. Gauge fields are just Lie group valued one forms on a three manifold. So we use a gauge transformation group acting like this. And this gauge group is a symmetry of this action functional. So if you don't know what is this functional, but you have seen it 2 days ago in the plenary lecture of Kronheimer and Dombrovka. I just changed the factor here to by multiplying by three because my slide didn't fit well to the picture. Okay, so the phase space, just a set of critical points of that functional is identified with a moduli space of flat connections. So in fact, we have to take a gauge group orbits of flat connections here. And this, in turn, is identified with a set of group homomorphisms, so of the fundamental group of the manifold M into G. And this space is finite dimensional. So we start from a field theoretical action functional. And due to a huge symmetry, we end up with a finite dimensional phase space. And that one of the reasons why this model is considered to be exactly solvable. And the main object of interest in quantum theory is a partition function, which has this formal definition, where dA is a so-called path integral, which is a very formal thing. And so as a result, the problem I will be concerned with is to give a mathematical rigorous definition and calculational recipe to get that number. And since the action functional does not depend on the metric on the manifold, so it's the partition function is expected to be a topological invariant. Of course, I will not give you the complete answer to this problem, but I will try to convince you that we have some part of the solution at least. So here is a selected choice of references I have taken, which describe a little bit the history of the subject, which starts actually exactly 50 years ago by the work of Reggio Ponzano, where they tried to use 6J symbols of the representation theory of the angular momentum to model 3 plus 1 dimensional gravity. But they didn't succeed completely because the partition functions were divergent But subsequently, it was realized, which finally was is considered to be a realization of the Chern-Simon theory with compact gauge groups. These are works of Richtig and Turayev, Turayev-Virol. Witten was first to point out the importance of the Chern-Simon functional from the viewpoint of applications in 2 plus 1 dimensional gravity models. So I will not comment on each item in this list, just I highlighted in blue my own contributions. And I would like to use this opportunity to thank my co-authors, Nikolai Rishtikhin, Nathan Geer, Vladimir Turayev, Jon Eldegard Andersen, Stavros Garifalidis, Feng Luo, and Grigory Vartanov. And in today's talk, the first part will be the quantization problem of Teichmuller space, which is part of the phase space of Chern-Simon theory with gauge group PSL2R. And then in the second part, I will describe the latest development we started with this paper, which led to three-dimensional TQFT model in the TQFT in the generalized sense, because the underlying vector spaces here will be infinite dimensional. Okay, so let's pick up a surface of genus G with S punctures. I suppose that there are at there is at least one puncture, and I suppose that the Euler characteristic is negative. We pick up this gauge group, we pick up this product three manifold, and then the Teichmuller space is just a connected component in the whole phase space of the model. And this component is characterized by the fact that it is composed with of discrete phase-full representations of the surface group into the gauge group, which is in turn can be identified with a set of hyperbolic structures on the surface. Then it carries, as any phase space, a symplectic structure, but since this is a geometric component, so its symplectic structure carries the name of Weyl-Peterson, which is known by independent research of mathematicians. And the next important property of Teichmuller space is the fact that the mapping class group of the surface acts on it by symplectomorphisms. And so the idea of quantization is just to pick up this symplectic space and perform a quantization. And we can hope that we will succeed in doing this, taking the fact that the Teichmuller space topologically is trivial. It is homeomorphic just to open bone. And that's why the canonical quantization in the physical sense of the term can work here. And to do this, we use the following useful fact. Namely, the mapping class group freely acts on a certain set called the decorated ideal triangulations. So ideal triangulation is just the cellular decomposition of the surface into triangles, where vertices live on the punctures. So, so if we add them back, then it's a cellular complex, then we remove the vertices, so that what remains the ideal triangulation. And decoration consists of marking a corner in each triangle and putting them in a linear order. This is the example of a sphere with four punctures. So these three triangles here, and the outside region is a fourth triangle. And they are enumerated, and the dots indicate the marked corners. And then we use the following algebraic fact. So as soon as we have a group freely acting on a set, then we can associate to it an algebraic object, which is a connected group poet, which means that we have a set of objects, which is identified with G orbits in the set. Morphisms are orbits in the Cartesian square. Then we have a source target maps, which just single out one of the two components. And then two morphisms are composable if so the target of one morphism coincides with the source of another one, And then at this moment, we use the freeness of the group action by identifying unique group element which sends U to Y, which lie in this the same orbit. And by using this fact, we just multiply this tomorphism in the following way. We bring this pair by acting by group element. We stay in the same orbit. Then we know that Y is equal to GU. And then we just forget about Y. We drop these middle terms, and we end up the product in the group void. And here I'm using the convention of composition in fundamental group voids. Identity element is just the two copies of the same element, and the inverse, we exchange the terms. And the important fact here is that we do not lose the information about the group. It shows up as a vertex morphism set for any element due to connectedness. And now let us see what this gives in our case of the mapping class group acting freely on the set of ideal triangulations. And, this recent theorem, but the statement of theorem was known for a long time, but it the proof, written proof, appeared only recently due to Hyun Kyu Kim. And it says the following. So the group point can be generated by two types of generators. So the first set, just the renumbering of the triangles. Second set, changing the mark corners. And the third set is diagonal flips. So the essential part is given by the generators of third type. And I'm using the notation which I introduced in the previous slide. So this writing means that it's at some big triangulation, two triangulations next to each other, which are identical outside the drawn parts, and differ only this in these fragments. So for example, this element differs only in mark corner of one chosen triangle, being identical outside, and so forth. And then the relations are given by the relations in the symmetric group. Then three relations which are characteristic to the group point. So for example, this relation says that if you change the corner three times, we get identity. Then the pentagonal five-term identity for the diagonal flips. And one more relation which mix up corner changes, diagonal flips, and transpositions. And there is one more set which I call trivial relations. They state just that, for example, two corner changes commute, or corner change and the diagonal flip commute if the corresponding triangles do not intersect. And the transpositions change the indices of other generators, and so on. And using this theorem, now we can introduce a main algebraic object, which I call basic algebraic system. So the formal definition is as follows. So we pick up a symmetric monoidal category, and we say that we have a basic algebraic system in C. If we have an object together with morphism in the endomorphisms of this object, and another element in the endomorphism of this tensor square, which verify three relations. And these relations just correspond to a second set of relations in Kim theorem. An immediate consequence of this definition is the following theorem, which says that as soon as we have a basic algebraic system, then we can construct a representation of our group point in the automorphism group of a certain tensor power of our object, where the transpositions are sent to symmetries of the category, corner changes are sent to R element with corresponding number, and diagonal flips are sent to W element. And the proof of this theorem is elementary, given that we have a previous theorem. And this definition is underlies the realization of the Teichmuller theory. So what we do, so we use Pender lambda coordinates in the decorated version of this Teichmuller space. And then we can, by taking the ratios of those coordinates, we can construct a basic algebraic system, which I call Teichmuller basic algebraic system, which is as follows. So it lives in the category of sets with Cartesian tensor product. And the object V is just the square of the positive reals. And two rational maps, which are given explicitly by this formula. And so it's a matter of direct verification that three relations in the definition of basic algebraic system are verified. And additionally, we can remark that the following symplectic structure is consistent with these rational transformations. And now, from this moment, we can forget about surfaces, mapping class groups, and so on, and just deal with basic algebraic systems, because due to previous theorem, we always can get back to mapping class groups for any surface just by using our objects. It's similar to Young-Buck's solution of Young-Buck's equation with respect to braid groups. Okay, now we proceed with quantization. So we have a symplectic space, and we have a symplectic morphisms given by rational maps R and W. And that just performing directly the quantization procedure. So we construct a quantum basic algebraic system in the Hilbert space of square integrable functions. So the R map is just a metaplectic unitary operator, which does not depend on Planck constant. So Planck constant is a parameter. So in fact, we are dealing with now with a one-parameter family of basic algebraic systems. And W operator is an essential part given by this formula, where it interferes a special function of one argument, which is defined here. And the Q hat, P hat are just standard Heisenberg operators normalized in a specific way. So we remove the Planck constant from the momentum operator, and it shows up in the spatial function. So here the parameter B is related to Planck constant in this way. And originally, this function was introduced by Faddeev in the context of a quantum, a discretized quantum Liouville theory. And in our case, as often happens in quantum theory, if we have a group of symplectic morphisms, then on quantizing, typically we get a projective representation of the corresponding group. Likewise here, so instead of just the basic algebraic system which I defined initially, we end up with projectivized version of it. So these relations stay intact. And in the last relation, we get a complex absolute value unit complex factor depending on the Planck constant. And so these two relations correspond to two relations for the Faddeev function. One is the inversion relation, corresponds to this one. And this is the most important part, is a five-term relation, which looks like this in the operator form. So remember that phi of x is a function which sends a real axis to the unit circle. So this is an identity for unitary operators. Very well defined, but if you are not easy with operator identities, here it's commutative counterpart given by integral identity for the function itself. Since everything lives on the unit circle, so this is not an absolutely convergent integral, it is conditionally convergent, it should be interpreted as an identity for temperate distributions given by bounded functions. Okay, so a few more remarks on the Fatjie function. So if we specify the Planck constant by special value, like one quarter, then one can observe that the function phi is given by exponential of a classical dilogarithm function in this form. And even more, we can trace back this function to another function noted capital F, which was introduced for the first time by Hölder on the name of a double sine function. And Hölder defined it as this infinite product. Then in the 70s, Shintani studied the complete generalized version in the context of number theory. And here is a remark on the relation to the Liouville central charge of our Planck constant. And the final remark concerns the quasi-classical behavior, so that which justifies the name quantum dilogarithm for that function. So as you see, we have a typical quasi-classical behavior in quantum theory, something finite divided by h bar. Okay, now we shift our attention to three dimensions. So any TQFT as a special case gives a representation of the mapping class group. Now we have a representation of a mapping class group coming from the quantum Teichmuller basic algebraic system. So the idea is to promote this representation to a TQFT. But since the representation is infinite dimensional, so we cannot hope that it will be a TQFT in the usual sense. But the minimal wish is to end up at least with well-defined partition functions for three manifolds which with invariance properties. And the idea is the following. So we had diagonal flips in the triangulated surfaces. So we want to interpret this in the three-dimensional perspective as an operation of gluing a tetrahedron to these two triangles along a backside faces. And the result will be the front faces of the tetrahedron, which appears as a diagonal flip. And this picture just is a starting point of a three-dimensional cobordism between triangulated surfaces. And the five-term relation for the flips corresponds to two, three Pachner moves, which underlie the topological invariance in the triangulated context. And then I will use the notion of triangulated manifolds, but I put them in the quotation marks because these triangulations do not correspond to simplicial complexes. They correspond to ordered delta complexes of Hatcher. That means basically the following thing. So first of all, it's a CW complex where all cells are standard simplexes given by this formula. And the standard simplexes come together with phase inclusion maps, n plus one phase inclusions for n-dimensional simplex. And then in the definition of ordered delta complex, we demand that if we have a characteristic map of an n cell, then the composition of that characteristic map with any phase map is again a cell, but of one dimension less. And this cell is called the ice boundary of the cell alpha. And x sub I will be the notation for the I dimensional cells of x, and x I comma j will be a set of pairs given by a I dimensional cell in x, and j dimensional cells of the standard I dimensional simplex. (Clears throat) Okay, so that's important slide. So it introduces the additional structure needed for for the construction of our three-dimensional TQFT. So it is called shape structure, and basically it corresponds to sorry. So it corresponds to assigning of dihedral angles of ideal hyperbolic tetrahedra to each three-dimensional cell of the triangulation. Apart from this, we use a gauge group action in the space of shape structures, which corresponds to action of total angles. So we have a Neumann-Zagier Poisson structure in the space of shape structures. I will say about it more concretely in the next slide. But here I would like to point out that total angles around geometrical edges generate a Poisson action in the space of shape structures, which I call gauge group action. A part of this, we say that H is balanced if the total angle is 2 pi. And the case of when all edges are balanced is known in math, in a geometric topology as an angle structure, first considered by Kesson, Leckinby, and Riven. And one more remark, that the Gage-Eukullian's class of shape structure stays invariant under modified versions of Wagner moves, where we include angles as a part of the data. Simply, we treat angles as additive objects, so the dihedral angle on this edge, for example, should be equal to the dihedral angle on this edge. And this immediately imposes the condition that the move is possible only if the internal edge is balanced. Okay, then we have a we introduce some colorings or labelings on tetrahedra. So first we remark that there are in an oriented triangulated pseudo-3 manifold we have two types of tetrahedra. Because of these two types cannot be related to each other by space rotations, so positive and negative. And then we color all to the faces of tetrahedron by real numbers, which we call quantum states. And we keep another assignment of dihedral angles, which come from shape structure. So as in any ideal hyperbolic tetrahedron, we have opposite angles are equal, and they sum up to pi. And here is a Neumann-Zagier symplectic structure corresponding to one tetrahedron. Okay, now we define the tetrahedral weight function. So first we introduce a function of 6 arguments. It's a Dirac delta function, simple oscillating exponential. So think that all arguments are real. So this oscillating exponential, and phi st is just is built up from Fourier function with complex arguments. Now, I'm using here the analytic properties of the Fourier function, which is a meromorphic function on the complex plane, and some exponential. And then for each oriented tetrahedron with labelings, x and alpha, we associate this weight function. So first two arguments come from angles or shape structure. And four remaining come from four faces. So these are quantum states, state variables. These are shape variables. And we keep this formula only for negative tetrahedra. And for all positive, we take the same formula, but complex conjugate. And then we can check that we have a quantum pentagon identity, where we should integrate now over internal faces, and we should balance the internal age. And the tetrahedral symmetry is realized covariantly on the level of these weight functions. And as a remark, connection with the Teichmuller basic algebraic system comes from the fact that if we switch off the angles, we end up with a flat tetrahedron where one angle is a pi. So it is just a flat quadrilateral with two diagonals. And in this case, the weight function is nothing else but the integral kernel of the W hat operator in the basic algebraic system. And now we are ready for the central definition of the theory. So if we have a closed oriented triangulate pseudo-3 manifold with shape structure alpha, then we associate to it the following partition function. So we restrict shape structure to each tetrahedron, and then we take the corresponding weight tetrahedral weight function, multiply over all tetrahedra, and integrate over all quantum states. And the theorem from our paper of 2014 with Andersen says that under this topological restriction, this partition function is well defined in the sense that integral converges, but important thing that it does not converge absolutely. You should think of, remember that the weight functions contain delta functions, so they should be treated as a distributions. And this statement is well defined, means that all these distributions can be multiplied without problem, and even more, all the quantum variables can be integrated out still without encountering the problem. But this is, in reality, the technical problem. We have later on, we had a new definition of the theory, which doesn't use any topological restriction. But anyway, in this form, we need it. And then we have important properties like, first of all, it depends only on the gauge equivalence class, and then it stays invariant under Bachner moves. And actually, I should add here that it also does not depend on the ordered triangulation. So if you change the order or in the triangulation, then it still stays invariant. But of course, the theory can be extended to any manifolds. And if you are interested, you can look at the paper which submitted to this ICM proceedings. You will see the details there. Okay, here is a simplest example of calculation. So geometrically, it corresponds to hyperbolic S3 with conical singularities along two embedded circles sharing one common point. Else, you can think of this. If you remove this, the common point of the circles, you will have a R3. And then there will be just two embedded copies of real line. And in reality, they are knotted and they are linked between themselves. So the from a physical point of view, one can think of this as a model of 2+1 gravity, where these lines correspond to world lines of massive particles, where masses correspond to angle deficits. Anyway, so in this setting, we can just do precise calculation. So the manifold is triangulated in one tetrahedron, where A, this face, is identified to outer face, and these two faces are identified between themselves by respecting the arrows on the edges. So in this way, the glue, there is only one possible identification. And we end up with two geometrical edges. This blue edge stays by itself, its total angle, just the angle at the tetrahedron, the alpha, and the five other edges are identified to the second geometric edge, and the angle will be 2 pi minus alpha. And effectively, this alpha parameterizes the gauge equivalence class of this shape structure. And if you calculate our partition function, it will be absolute value of the Fadi function evaluated at this argument, which is the same as this double sine function, which is a real value here, so no absolute value needed. And as you see, it depends only on the variable alpha, even if at the input we had also beta gamma. So that's the gauge invariance property of the partition function. And now we can see the asymptotic limit when h bar goes to zero, and we observe the exponential decay with Planck constant in the denominator, so typical quasi-classical behavior in quantum theory, with some coefficient denoted volume of x alpha. And this volume is calculated just by maximizing the volume of this hyperbolic ideal tetrahedron with three angles, where we keep the angle alpha fixed because it is a total angle around this edge, and so it's gauge invariant. But beta and gamma can be varied by gauge transformation, so if we maximize it, we get a number depending on alpha, which is calculated explicitly in terms of Lobachevsky function. And the convenient thing is to use a Milner formula for the volume of ideal hyperbolic tetrahedron, even by this beautiful formula. Okay, so this calculation now suggests us to formulate a conjecture about the asymptotic behavior of the partition function in general when h bar goes to zero. So the conjecture is as follows. So let us denote bracketed alpha the gauge equivalence class of shape structure alpha. And then we just take sums of tetrahedral volumes for each simplex in the triangulated three manifold, and maximize this sum staying in the equivalence, gauge equivalence class of alpha. We get some number which now depends only on the gauge equivalence class. And the volume conjecture for our partition function tells us that the asymptotic behavior of the absolute value is controlled by this quantity. So if we specify, now we can calculate any example we want as soon as the topological restriction is respected. In particular, we can do some knot theory by taking knot complements as three manifolds, triangulating them, providing with shape structure, and calculating. And the result is that this behavior is confirmed at least for these two knots, which was done by in my paper with Andersen. Later, Andersen and Kratman-Nissen proved it for next hyperbolic knot. Then Benaribi and Pige Nakazawa proved it for infinite set of twist knots. And even more, we can do also knot theory in other three manifolds. So Pige Nakazawa has some results for knots in three-dimensional projective space. So I should point out here that I use long dashes and short dashes to distinguish between different people and one of the same people. So Kratman-Nissen is the one person. So Andersen and Kratman-Nissen, these are two persons. So Benaribi is one person. So you see the short dash. Pige Nakazawa is another person. Okay. Okay, so to summarize, let me, no, it doesn't work. It doesn't switch. Ah, yeah, okay. So by using the framework of triangulations, we have shown that quantum Teichmuller space theory gives rise to a generalized version of three-dimensional topological quantum field theory. And in this construction, the essential part was played by shape structures coming from three-dimensional hyperbolic geometry. And in particular, these shape structures ensure not only topological invariance, but also the convergence property, which is crucial in this sort of theory, because the underlying vector spaces are infinite dimensional. And unlike the usual quantum topology calculations, where we deal with always with finite sums, here we deal with either infinite sums or integrals. So convergence is always an issue. And somehow, amazingly, shape structures help to solve this problem here. And finally, so we observed on the level of explicit calculations that in the quasi-classical limit, the hyperbolic volume shows up. And this justifies the fact that our theory has something to do with my motivation in the beginning, that we at least catch some part of Chern-Simon theory with non-compact gauge group given by the isometry group of three-dimensional hyperbolic space. And the theory is developed further. So by now, we have already a generalized family of TQFTs where a part of the Planck constant H bar, we have an integer variable which corresponds to quantum SL2C Chern-Simon theory, where we know from first principles that there are two coupling constants. One is continuous, serving for non-compact directions in the SL2C group. And one variable is discrete, serving for compact directions in the SL2C group. But these versions are more complicated and more research is needed. So I think I stop here and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Rinat, for the nice talk. So the talk is now open to questions. Are there questions? I have a question. So in those cases when the conjecture is proved, I mean for those knots, are you able to work out also the semi-classics, I mean the rate of convergence?
But the rate of convergence is a part of the...
Yeah.
Maybe I don't understand your question.
So one more. So you know the limit, and now do you have the error term? I mean, how fast does it converge?
Ah, first the terms, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, but these are not work out, but there is a general expectation, so-called asymptotic expansion conjecture, where which predicts basically the whole expansion. Mm-hmm. And as the next term, there will be Rademaster torsions, twisted Rademaster torsions around the geometric structure.
Thank you. So, more questions? If not, let's thank Rinat again.
Thank you.